One of their top concerns has been Common Core, and that's based on feedback that they were getting from their members. They were getting phone calls, and people are very upset with what was going on in the educational curriculum and standards known as Common Core.
Or not much about Common Core. How is this even possible? Why are the majority of parents just learning about the core years after its adoption and implementation? This is inexcusable.
We're late in the game. We all been doing this in 2010. But like the chamber and everybody else, we bought into it and passed the blooming bill.
It identifies what students should know and be able to do in mathematics and the English language arts as a result of being in our school.
And prior to joining FreedomWorks in 2012, she was an eighth grade school teacher. She taught U.S. history. So who better to talk about Common Core than a former teacher? She went to battle for us, the Common Core. Since last January, she has testified in 14 states against Common Core. She has also been a guest host on Fox and Friends, Glenn Beck's The Blaze, CNN, NBC Nightly News, ABC, and now here tonight, Lake Norman Conservatives.
In undergraduate school, I double majored in poli sci, actually in PR, and or major minor, and then I went and got a master's degree in public policy and administration. While I was in school to get my master's degree, a lot of my professors were talking about this great thing called Race to the Top and Common Core and these new standards that the government was providing to the states and how wonderful it was going to be to give local schools these standards from the government that were going to make everybody smarter. And as we know from looking at No Child Left Behind, anytime the federal government steps into the local classroom, it's not good. Good things don't happen. In fact, it makes life miserable for teachers. Kids struggle, and we start to see layers of bureaucracy build and build and build on the local classroom and the local school until they actually can't meet logical goals. So I taught in a city called Coppell, also north of Dallas, right by DFW Airport. And one of the unique experiences that I had being a child in the school is we had a lot of kids that were bused in from cities around Coppell that had low socioeconomic backgrounds. And so I got to teach kiddos that by the time they got to the eighth grade, they still couldn't read a fifth or sixth grade textbook. and they were really struggling with just basic knowledge and vocabulary. And so in that experience, I was given several grants and opportunities to use different types of technology, and I was freed from our district's accountability system in my classroom. So I was able to kind of do whatever I wanted with my students based on the period of the day and the kids I had in the room. So it was very nice to have that kind of freedom, because people don't have it. So we talk about education reform, we talk about standards. A lot of people think, if you're out there saying you hate Common Core, you don't like teachers, and you don't like schools in general, and you're against public schools. And that's not where I come from. I think every school, every educational opportunity has a purpose. You go back. Yeah. I do believe, just so you know where I'm coming from when I give you this whole story about Common Core, that every child, regardless of their background, should have access to a quality education. I'm a high active supporter of school choice opportunities. I do believe that every child is unique. And so that means that teachers have to be able to recognize that every kid in our classroom is a unique person who's come to their classroom from a different background, a different life experience, and a different learning level. So every kid that you see during the day isn't able to grasp the concept that you're teaching in the exact same way, or to give you the information back in the exact same way. We all learn differently at different times. And that families should have the ability to choose the best educational opportunities for their children. Whether that's homeschooling, charter schools, or public schools. So when I say all that, these guys right here, probably recognize some of them, have decided that they know better than you, better than teachers, better than people who've been in the classroom, better than anyone, how your kids should be educated. Do you guys recognize any of the pictures on the screen?
Yeah.
Yes? Do you like these guys?
No.
All right. So we've got Bill and Melinda Gates there on the left. You've got former governor, Jeb Bush. You've got Arnie Duncan, our current Secretary of Education. And something people don't realize, I don't know, how many of you know Arnie Duncan's background before he became the Secretary of Education?
Chicago.
When you hear Secretary of Education, you would assume that person had been a teacher, right? Never. Arnie Duncan was never a teacher. He was actually an administrator in Chicago's public school system. All right, so this should come as no surprise to you why he's our current Secretary of Education. But Arnie has never been a teacher. He knows better than you what your kids should be learning, but he's never tried to teach it to them. You've got Michael Bloomberg. He wants to tell you how big of a soda you can drink, and now wants to tell you how to teach your kids. And then Warren Buffett, who I guess his secretary, was really upset about her health care and all sorts of other things. So these guys, the reason I call them your new national school board is because they get together on a yearly basis. And they're actually the architects, the funders, and the developers behind Common Core. And we'll go into this in more detail. But they go to these private retreats along with Oprah and David Coleman and a couple other people. And they really put this entire system together. So when I call them your national school board, it's because they've actually taken power from your local school board and their ability to do their jobs and replaced it with this system that we're going to talk about today. So, and I kind of mentioned this already, combined years in the classroom of that group, zero. None. But their impact on education is limitless because of the money they have behind them and the relationships that they've formed with one another. And unfortunately, your ability to have a say in the situation has been completely eliminated. Common Core itself. Okay, so look at the bolded words. If you want to look at anything on this page, uniform. We've got local, eliminating local control, limiting parental involvement. We've got invasive data collection. We've got special interest influence. It's like a microcosm of this administration into the education system. But Common Core is a set of standards. So these are the things that at the end of the school year, your kids are expected to know or to learn once they complete a specific grade level. So how do we get here? I showed you a picture of the National School Board. If you ask Arnie Duncan, he'll tell you this all magically started in 2009. But in reality, it goes all the way back to 1996. And in theory and in philosophy, it goes back a lot farther. But in 1996, this group called ACHIEVE is formed by the National Governors Association and some national corporations like Microsoft, IBM, GE, Prudential Insurance, State Farm, other groups, got together and formed this nonprofit organization called ACHIEVE. In 1998, they started a project. It was a national standards and benchmarking project. Basically, these guys got in a room and said, we're struggling. The workforce that we're getting out of the public education system, they don't have the basic skills that they need to be successful in the workforce. The literacy level is low, the technical skill is low. We need to figure out a way to fix this. So good intentions, right? We all agree that it's good intentions. Education reform is a necessary need. Okay, we will watch how this evolves into something that's not good. So from 1998 to 2001, these guys start meeting and coming up with lists of what are the skills that the average person who's going to enter the workforce, what do they need to be able to do? What would make our companies more successful if every entry-level employee had this basic skill set? So in 2001, they start a summit, and they invite anyone who works for a corporation or is involved in education to this summit for these must-have skills. And they start working at that point with a company called Pearson. Has anybody heard of Pearson Education before? Okay, so you guys like Pearson? All right, so we're all on the same page. Good, this is good. So Pearson is actually a company based out of the United Kingdom, and I'll go into detail about them later. But their interests aren't ours, and their interest is definitely profiting off individual children in the classroom. So we'll talk about that some more. So they do this, and then they start writing a document. And in 2004, so again, all of this for a long period of time, they released something called Ready or Not, Creating a High School Diploma That Counts. So they're focusing on English and math standards. And they say these are the things that are most needed for the workforce. Well, Bill and Melinda Gates get a hold of this document. They're like, oh, we like this. This is really cool. We've saved Africa and we're vaccinating everybody. What's the next thing that we can get involved in? I think we should save public education. So Bill and Melinda throw some money behind it. And in 2007, they pledged $60 million to the creation of national standards. Now that $60 million is nothing compared to what they spent as of today. But in 2007, they made the $60 million pledge. In 2008, they added an additional $2 million to convince the governors that these are a good idea. So they're gonna create them, and then they're gonna convince the governors that this is what you guys need to improve your states. So in 2008, the National Governors Association and the Council of Chief State School Officers, it's a mouthful, right? They write a document, and I have it here. Actually, do I have it here? I have it in this big stack of things. There's a document called Benchmarking for Success, which was funded by the Gates Foundation. We know what happened in November 2008. We elect Barack Obama as president. The only document provided to President Obama for his transition to the White House regarding education was this document. Okay? So Benchmarking for Success is provided to him, funded by the Gates and Oprah and all his friends. And they tell them, this is what you need to do. This should be your education agenda when you get to the White House. And by the way, your friend Arnie back in Chicago would be great to do this. Okay? So, and we know how great Chicago public schools are. So let's make them the example of the rest of the country. All right. So at the same time that they're doing all of this, the federal government is obviously facing some financial problems. We've got banks that are failing. States were unable to meet their individual budgetary requirements, so states are cash-strapped. So they offer this stimulus package that we know is the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act. You've seen those beautiful signs on the highway that are like, this project has been going on forever. Yes. It's funded by this great government program. Okay, well they did this to your schools too. They pledged $4.35 billion to Race to the Top. This is how they determined that they could get Common Core from these special interest groups to the government, to your classrooms. By asking the states to apply for funding through the stimulus package, apply for this grant program. By applying for the program, whether they received money or not, they would be, hold on, sorry, I'm gonna knock this over. I'm so angry. they must accept the standards. This wasn't if you get the money, you take the standards. It's if you sign the grant application, you are now accepting the standards. Have I shown anybody on this timeline where they actually gave people a copy of the standards to look at?
No.
Because they hadn't, they weren't written yet. So they were telling the governors, you've got to take these before you read them. Pelosi 101, right? You've got to adopt these standards before we give you the money, or we may not even give you the money. And then you'll be holding to them, to the next. At the same time this is happening, our good friends over at the Gates Foundation talk to Arnie, and Arnie hires one of their top officials to be his chief of staff. They also create another department within the Department of Education called the Office of Innovation and Improvement and hire another Gates Foundation official to run that department. How many of you are familiar with the Department of Education and their budget? So an interesting statistic for you. Every dollar that is spent by the Department of Education, 11 cents of it actually make it into a classroom. 11. 79 cents of that actually stay within DC, within the Department of Education itself, to fund salaries, conferences, benefits, programs, building maintenance, office supplies. So 79% of the Department of Education's budget actually never leaves the building. It's a big building if you've ever been to DC. It's very nice. There's a lot of teachers in Title I schools around the country that look at the Department of Education and they're like, really? That's nice. So anyway, they don't spend a lot actually on schools. So the Gates Foundation hired or sends over some of their friends to work in the Department of Education. June 1st, so this is before anybody's ever seen a standard, still, June 1st, 2009, Congress actually revises their educational objectives. So they've taken this initial document, the Benchmarking for Success document, they've decided that they like it, and they add data to it. And data's gonna come in down the road. We've heard of the NSA, we've heard of the IRS. They want to collect a lot of data on your kids. So this is the first time data enters the equation. And in March of 2010, they released this document right here. It's called Blueprint for Reform. Paid for by your taxpayer dollars, 99 pages. You can download it, just Google Blueprint for Reform. It's the reauthorization of the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, ESEA. In this document, they decide that not only are we gonna try to bribe states through these applications to take Common Core, but now the federal formula funding that you already get, so the funding you already get to help Title I schools and kids from low socioeconomic backgrounds, if you don't take Common Core, we're not gonna give you that money anymore. So on page 11, bottom of the page, goes over to page 12. That's really scary, because we're now seeing our federal government tying other funding to the implementation of a national standards program that's already unconstitutional. That was in March of 2010. In March, when they did this, that was when the very first drafts of the standards were released. The applications for round one of Race to the Top were due in April. They're 364-page applications. So if you can only imagine how far people were along in the process before they saw the first draft of the standards. June 1st was the deadline for phase two of the Race to the Top grant applications. The final draft was not given out until the day after the deadline to apply for the funding. Now, here's an interesting story for you, and I forget her name, and I apologize to her, not that she cares. Your state superintendent of education. Thank you. Last summer, I had the pleasure of speaking at a forum with her. And in the forum, someone raised their hand and said, did you sign the application before you saw the final draft of the standards? She said, no, absolutely not. I would never do that. I would never sign an application before seeing the final version of the standards that we would be beholden to. So on my phone, Googling North Carolina's Race to the Top application, she signed it May 26th. Her signature, with her writing the date now, May 26th. When did you guys get the standards copy? June 2nd. So yes, she did. She took your children and made them responsible and beholden to Common Core standards before she saw the final draft of what those standards would look like.
And then, once the State Board of Education adopted the standards in 2010, they also adopted all of the other standards. And then, after that took place, we had an opportunity to apply for $400 million from Race to the Top. And in our proposal, you will see over and over and over a focus on we are going to use the Common Core.
And I just want to reiterate the negative effects on kids. Title I funding is really important to the communities because of the public school finance system, because of No Child Left Behind, because most of our states have inadequate public school finance programs where people think spend means better, 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 and it's very poorly allocated. Title I funding is something those schools really depend on, and they rely on for reading programs and after-school programs and different things that are beneficial to kids. I taught at a Title I school. We would not have been able to protect kids and their communities from certain things had we not had Title I funding. In a state like Texas that did not take Race to the Top money and did not apply for it, the mere thought of losing Race to the Top or losing our Title I funding because of that is very, very, very scary. And it's coercion from the federal government to the states to comply, or we are going to hurt your children. That's just absolutely unacceptable. No Child Left Behind. Everybody is unhappy with the requirements for No Child Left Behind. Your waiver to be eliminated from those requirements is tied to your participation in Common Core and Common Core assessments. Ooh. So there's two layers of coercion now to the states. Comply, or we're going to make it difficult for you guys to be successful. So I call these guys the Common Core group. Again, the most of you saw their pictures in the beginning. You've got the creators, the Lenegades, and some corporations. You've got the people who actually developed the standards, the National Governors Association, the Council of Chief State School Officers, and ACHIEVE. How many of you guys have heard that Common Core was state-led or been told, hey guys, you don't have to worry about it, it was state-led? A lot of you guys have heard that. So it wasn't. Both the NGA and the CCSSO are based out of D.C., and they formed ACHIEVE, which is also based out of D.C.
They say it's a federal intrusion into local and state communities. What would you say to that?
Clearly, these standards have become political because even though governors, state education chiefs were the ones who were leading this effort initially, once Obama took office, I think he really, in a lot of ways, tried to take credit for them, tried to politicize them, and that's led to some of the concern, I think, in some conservative circles.
And so then we've got the players. So who are the people that are really putting this into your communities? The Department of Education, the publishing companies, the testing companies, the data companies. And who's making it sound good? So you've got Jeb Bush, Fordham Institute, the Hunt Institute, the Chamber, ironically the National PTA, and the National Association of School Boards. Well, if you look at a PR machine list, every single one of those groups has received $1 million or more dollars from Bill and Melinda Gates to promote the standards separately. $1 million or more.
But Common Core truly is something that was started by states and needs to stay a state-led initiative.
The development process for the Common Core, quite simple, in that there were higher ed leaders, there were experts in content, there were classroom-level teachers. And then, as Dr. Pierce pointed out, once the standards were written, there was consultation with people across the states, and before they were adopted in North Carolina, there was consultation just with people in North Carolina.
So again, to reiterate my last point, they say it's state-led, but both of those organizations are based out of D.C. The really scary thing, they're both organizations that are not accountable to you, and they own the standards. So if they don't work for your kids, they don't change. Because they own them. You'd have to like get on the bus all together and show up at my office building and I'd get with you. You could knock on their door and tell them how much you hate them, but they're not gonna listen. But they own the standards, and we'll go into that more here in a little bit. I'm trying to go fast because sometimes this takes me like 2 hours and I don't want to do that to you. And that's what we're talking about. So ACHIEVE. These are the people, this group behind Common Core, these are their financial contributors. Keep that in your mind. Keep that National School Board in your mind. Keep these corporations in your mind as we go forward. So what is that national vision? So we've got benchmarking for success, and we've got this blueprint for reform document. The co-chairs of the committee to create it, Janet Napolitano, we love her, right? She's awesome. won't go there. There's cameras. But you've got Microsoft, Fordham, Hunt, and the National Council of La Raza funding and writing the information that are in this document. And then Bill and Linda Gates and the GE Foundation generously supported the preparation of this vision of what the government is going to do to education. So specifically, they want to upgrade your state standards. They don't think you know what you're doing well enough, so they're going to tell you how to do it better by adopting a common core of internationally benchmarked standards. So they're telling you in the beginning, they're going to benchmark these things to prove to you they're going to make us more competitive internationally. They want to leverage some collective influence. They really want to take the states and make you guys collectively influential redistribution of intelligence, collective influence, and make sure that everything is aligned 100%. So your kids are doing the same thing, the same day, at the same time, so there's fairness across the board. They want to revise your state policies for how you train and you get your teachers ready to be in the classroom. And this is word for word, actually, out of the document. I didn't make this up. And they want to hold schools and systems accountable through federal monitoring interventions and support. And they want to measure your state level performance globally. So they want to measure North Carolina to China. Okay, they actually acknowledge in the document setting up national standards. This one right here, this multi-page document, actually details every time in this document and in Race to the Top, they violated the Constitution. Several pages of constitutional violations, and I'm willing to share that with Hoover. And they reference the federal government's responsibility to provide states with data systems and longitudinal data tracking tools. It's the responsibility of the government to make sure that your states can do this. Okay, I'll go back one more. Okay, when I talk about competition with education systems, and over and over and over, they talk about how great China is, how great Singapore is, how great Korea is, how we really want to emulate their education systems. Jeffrey Immelt, have you guys heard of Jeffrey? Okay, so GE, he's on TV a lot talking about how beautiful communism is, how much he loves it. He's actually, there's a video, and I can only imagine that's part of his vision, where he talks about visiting schools in China and how beautiful it was that if you were on the East Coast or if you were on the West end of China, kids were doing the same day thing, the same day, at the same time, in the classrooms across the country. So it doesn't matter where you are, it's beautiful, because they're all doing the same thing at the same time. He says cogs in a wheel. Okay. Other thing that you should be aware of is that throughout both documents, and I can show you multiple pages, they call children human capital. And they talk about how we're going to raise the level of our human capital here in America.
Representing more than 35,000 members who employ over 1.2 million North Carolinians. I want to thank the committee for its attention on an issue that is critical to North Carolina employers. In March of last year, the organized business community launched their long-term vision to support our state's future as a globally competitive economic force. North Carolina Vision 2030 focuses on four key areas where our state must strive for excellence, the first of which is education and talent supply. North Carolina Vision 2030 states that in working to be the most competitive place to do and work and find a job in the world, North Carolina must provide support and professional development for teachers as they implement higher educational standards for our students who are our future workforce.
There is a mismatch that exists between the skills students are learning in schools and the skills that businesses need to succeed in the 21st century.
In North Carolina, we have a skills gap. Our innovation is outpacing the skills of our citizens who are filling real local jobs in critical industries like manufacturing, agriculture, and technology. It is critical that we move forward with and build upon these higher standards in order to provide our students a strong, world-class education that prepares them for life and the workforce, as well as providing certainty and predictability for businesses seeking talent throughout the state. Not doing so will put North Carolina at a competitive disadvantage against our neighboring states and the rest of the nation. Our economy and our businesses will suffer as job creators look to grow, attract, and retrain the skilled workers for the jobs of today and tomorrow.
And one of the questions that I've been asked frequently, well, are they field tested? Well, how do you go about field testing what students should know and be able to do? You do that by asking the people who will be the receivers of our students, our community colleges, our universities, our people in the workplace. What do we want them to know and be able to do?
Thank you, committee members, Mr. Chairman, for this time today. We appreciate your attention to this critically important jobs issue for North Carolina.
Not children, not students, not the future of our country, but our human capital. So taking the person, the individual, out of the equation, and they really do look at our children as data points and cogs on a wheel. So there's a fallacy to all of this. We're constantly told, and you've probably seen, how many of you have seen a study where they say Finland and China and Korea, their kids rank higher than us in science and math? So raise your hand if you've seen something that looks like that on the news.
The new international reading, math, and science scores were released, and Chinese students left American teens in the dust.
Right now, the U.S. ranks 31 in K-12 education.
35 other countries score higher than we do in math. We used to be at the top of these lists, folks.
Here's the newsflash. We educate every child in this country, from the child with Down syndrome to the child with autism to the child who has learning disabilities. We assess 98% of our students. There are very few limitations to children who do not receive an assessment in this country, and we report all of those scores. China, they don't educate all of their children past the 6th or 8th grade. They don't test beyond the top 10 to 25% of their students. So when you're looking at that, it's not an apples to apples comparison. You're looking at China's top 10 to 20% score versus our 100% score. So don't buy into the fallacy. Now, we need education reform, don't get me wrong. But don't buy into that. We need these national standards just like China has to compete with China. Because by the time kids are in eighth grade in China, they've already been told whether they're going to get a job, they're going to go work in a field, they're going to get to go to college. They've already told their kids that. They don't count those test scores in the equation when they show you those rankings. Okay. So keep that in mind, because we see that on TV all the time. And the other thing to do with that too is we don't want to put ourselves in the position where we've idolized a system that no longer exists. Last summer, China released a study, and I'll share that with whoever wants it as well. I'll give you my email address at the end, where they studied patents and innovation around the world. And they actually said they're leaving a national education system and they've been regionalizing their education system because what they had doesn't work. And they were trying to be more competitive with the rest of the world in innovation and patents, and so they're leaving that system. Why would we release a 99-page document that says we want to be more like something that they're running away from? It doesn't make any sense. So not only are the standards not really designed to actually make us internationally competitive, but they're poor. Dr. Sandra Stotsky, she was the Associate Commissioner of Massachusetts Department of Education. If you've looked at education standards around the country, if you've looked at student performance, if you've looked at post-graduation success, Massachusetts had a great program, and she was part of the development of that program. She was asked to look at the English language arts standards in Common Core. She refused to sign off on them because she thought they were so horrible. Dr. Stotsky is liberal. Okay? She actually is typically somebody that wouldn't align with us on issues. And she thought these were so bad she couldn't put her name to them. She gave them pages and pages and pages of feedback on individual standards. She calls them empty skill sets. Something I learned from her is that in 10th grade, one of the required reading pieces of material is the EPA government manual. I didn't know that until I met her, and she told me that that was part of the required standards. And then we'll talk about math. So Dr. James Milgram, he's a professor emeritus at Stanford. He's actually the only math expert that was part of the validation committee. He said that by the end of fifth grade, our kids would be 2 years behind. So with standards that we're being told are going to make us so much better, the average American student would actually be 2 years behind by the seventh grade. And who knows where by the 12th grade. Another expert that I talked to specifically said to me, and I wrote this down in my notes after the meeting, these math standards are designed for students entering a two-year community college, not a four-year university program. So Dr. Stotsky and Dr. Milgram and several other members of the committee, they also have questioned why the people on the standards writing committee weren't educational experts. They were testing experts. So there were people from companies like Pearson who write tests. And those were the people who were writing the standards. Not people who've been in a classroom or academic experts who actually have experience in the field that they represent. Feedback by the committees were filtered by five people. So you had standards written by this bubble here at the top, and then two committees look at the math and language arts. And then five people. So these are standards that are going to be given to all of the students in 45 states and four territories, all Department of Defense schools. Five people looked at them. They have no idea what happened to the validation committee's suggestions because they never received it. They were never given the recommendations by the content area experts about the specific standards, and their suggestions were not reflected in that final draft that was given out in June 2010, that draft that's being used in the states today.
With the study that you presented here, exactly who's determining the grades that you're giving each of the standards? I mean, there's a sentence here that says, the greatest weakness of North Carolina standards is that there's no priority given to real academic content. Who has determined what real academic content is?
Mr. Brickman.
Sure, appreciate the question. So this was a combination of some of our internal staff, and there were experts that took the time to look at every single state's standards.
How do you tell a second grader the reason that they're at home crying over the dinner table over homework they don't understand is because a couple guys that run a testing program that want to make a few bucks wrote those standards that are not telling your teacher what to teach you in the classroom? There's zero transparency for that. Okay, also, they were never piloted. So in my teaching experience and in my district, if we wanted to try something new, if it was a new reading program or a new textbook, we would pilot it for a year or two. So maybe the seventh graders would try this flipped classroom idea for a year or two. We'd watch and see how it happened. And if it worked, we would then take it across the whole district. These standards were never piloted, never tested on kids, never exposed to kids before they were given to every single place beholden to Common Core to implement on day one of the school year last year. That's really scary. We have no idea if these things work. And we're giving them to kids and saying, oh, by the way, this is going to make you really, really smart. You're going to be smarter than China. Here you go. Good luck. Good luck, teachers. Good luck, kids. There's no transparency or no, transition period. That's the word I'm looking for. There we go. No transition period. So one of the things that's happened is because there was no transition period. Let's say in your state, in second grade, kids are expected to know how to multiply by the end of second grade. But under the new standards, that's an expectation by the end of the first grade. So the next year's second graders, when they get these standards in this curriculum, they're expected to teach as though the kids already know how to multiply, because that's a first grade standard under the new system. So you've lost an entire year of teaching, but that teacher, when those kids take the test at the end of the year, they have to teach them all that new stuff. So it's caused turmoil among teachers and students because there's a gap of what they were supposed to learn from their old standards to these new federally mandated standards. And testing. We all love tests. So when people apply for a race to the top, one of the biggest requirements was that they participate in a national testing consortia. That's really where a lot of the bribery and coercion comes from, is that your state has to participate in a test that reflects Common Core standards, a set of standards common to a majority of states, which obviously is this. So two groups were formed, and Gates and Race to the Top funded them. And so they're next generation assessments, mostly developed by Pearson, to give to your kids. Formula funding, again, is now tied to those assessments. In some states, kids will spend up to 30 days taking standardized tests of their school year. That's really scary. It's a lot of time for kids to sit now in front of a computer rather than a pencil and paper test because these tests are digital. It's a lot of money for your individual school districts because you have to have enough computers for every kid to access at the same time on the same day because you can't have one class take the test on Monday and the other on Tuesday because they can tell their friends what was on the test. So you've got to have enough access to technology. These kids can all be taking it at the same time. Race to the Top didn't fund upgrading your technology systems in your local school district. That's your job and your local tax base's job to figure that out.
Superintendent Atkinson, appreciate your presentation, but I have a resolution for my local LEA that has a lot of concerns about how where the funds going to come from the continuation of technology, particularly in low-income areas, to make sure that these students have the same opportunity as other students. And they have a lot in this resolution, which I'm going to share with the chairman. But could you answer that question specifically? You talked about race to the top monies. What are the additional resources for technology in low-income areas, professional development? How do we see that in the future?
Now, the Winston Center for Science Board of Education was gracious enough to also share that resolution with us. I, like the Winston-Salem Board of Education, have concerns about the continued support of technology. It's really important to remember that regardless of which standards North Carolina has, we would have the same needs for technology. Because in that commission, we have recommended that we move to a digital environment. And if we had adopted the standards from Siberia, we would still have that problem. The General Assembly has passed the legislation dealing with digital learning. A part of that is to determine the educational needs, but the technology needs by school, by classroom. We are implementing that law. And we will have those costs for the General Assembly. However, we are looking beyond the General Assembly as a place of where we can meet those technology needs, including private partnerships, foundations, etc.
And then we've got the SAT ACT debacle. This has been in the news a lot lately. This guy right here, his name's David Coleman. He's a really good friend of Arne Duncan and President Obama. He's considered the architect of Common Core. He was part of a lot of these validation committees and these meetings. He was hired to be the director of the College Board in 2012, which administers the SAT and the Advanced Placement Program. So if your kids are in high school and take advanced placement classes or AP tests, he's in charge of those. He has now redesigned the AP tests to reflect Common Core and is in the middle of redesigning the SAT tests to reflect Common Core standards and processes.
The alignment of the Common Core standards with what is assessed on ACT, SAT, the National Assessment of Education Progress, that is very positive for our students and our parents, because it shouldn't be a mystery when it comes to a child wanting to be admitted to the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, or NC State, or North Carolina A&T, to try to have to figure out what's going to be assessed on an SAT or an ACT. So that is a very positive component of the work.
But now, the SAT test, the vocabulary, you know, we would all stress out over those SAT words, that really hard vocabulary. Not anymore. They're college and career ready words that were taken from the Common Core standards to be workplace based words. So like words that you would find in a technical manual or that would help you, you know, form a database. So that's what they've done. They've also made the writing portion optional. A few weeks ago, I saw him on TV and I was saying it's just not fair to kids who can't read or write to expect them to be compared to other kids on the writing portion because they can't do it. And they went to really bad schools where they didn't learn how to read and write. So we should make it optional. So only the kids who can read and write do the optional writing portion. And they're not penalized for not being able to do it. So rather than actually come up with a reform that impacts education and makes things better, just gotta tell them it's okay. Don't worry about it. So yeah, that's awesome. And the ACT has already redesigned their program. They did that a few years ago. All right, so cronyism. It's a fun word to say, right? Pearson, they're a UK-based company, they're a publisher. You'll see some names here. Last few lines. This should look very familiar. Pretty much every textbook your kids touch in the classroom from kindergarten through college has crossed the desk of some editor at Pearson. Keep going. Thank you. Pearson, actually my home state of Texas, we have a really bad experience with them, but Texas and New York, we've gone after Pearson heavily for being a monopoly on public education. Backstory on Pearson, they're really smart. They have representatives here in the United States that donate a lot to your state legislators' campaigns, to your Senate governors, your state boards of education, your state senators, and your state house members. They become really good friends with your state legislators. So when it comes time to award those contracts for digital resources, for standards development, or testing, guess who they call? They're good friends of Pearson that was a campaign donor. They also fund teacher conferences, teacher education materials, prep programs, trips, all sorts of stuff. Pearson's name is everywhere. So they become really good friends with all the people who then reward them. In Texas, 2009, we gave them a $495 million contract to rewrite our state standards and our testing. So they had a seat at the table to write the standards, and they wrote all the tests that our kids would take. The implementation was so bad that in our state session last spring, they scrapped the entire thing and are starting over. $500 million of waste. We have, it's CSCOBA, but yeah, I heard you say that. CSCOBA is tied directly into Pearson. Yes, it's our, it's because we didn't take race to the top, it's our version of Common Core. It's the same cronyism, same people, different name. Interesting enough, when they built out that $495 million system, it included $90 million a year of maintenance after the system was implemented on things like requiring individual districts to have an employee whose sole job was to talk to Pearson every day and figure out like what pencil we should use and what Scantron we should use and all that good stuff that's really hard for people to do. We needed a full-time employee in every school district to do that. And the districts also had to fund those employees to go to conferences with Pearson and pay for them to go to those conferences. And they also made a test, interestingly enough, where they didn't use a Scantron that had ever been invented before, and I think there's like 900 versions of them. So the districts actually had to buy new machines to scan the new Scantrons, and they had to buy them from Pearson. So it's amazing. Like, what would we do without them? So anyway, these guys are pocketing a lot of money off of Common Core as well. So they actually received $3 million from Bill and Melinda Gates to develop the digital resources to implement Common Core in the classroom. So they're given an investment, but they actually seek to make $8 billion back from your states who are required to then purchase these systems. When I say required, it's they'll come back and say, well, we don't say you have to make them, but if they're the only people who made them and your kids have to take these tests, it's kind of required. So, and they even said, I don't know if you want to flip back, they talk about how it's a really big deal because they're going to make a lot of money. And then there's Jeb, and I apologize if any of you in this room love Jeb. I will give Jeb a lot of credit for school choice. Unfortunately for Jeb, he's destroyed school choice in Florida and across the country because with Common Core, with the testing, and with the SAT and ACT, he's made school choice irrelevant if at the end of the day your kid can't even get into college if they haven't learned under Common Core. And we'll talk a little bit about the race to the top grades that were given to universities too. But they've given him $1.1 million to promote them. He built a toolkit for teacher resources. And if you look at his biggest donors, it's all the same people that are directly behind Common Core and the development of the Common Core standards. And it's really disappointing to see somebody who really was a leader in choice, even though we're not fans of the Bush family's No Child Left Behind legacy, the choice aspect of it is really disappointing. The reason he's included in all this is not only the money, but in March of last year, he attended one of those private meetings that was his first, like, his inaugural gala with them or whatever, on Kiowa Island with these guys at a private retreat. They spent a weekend together. That's actually about 3 months before the social studies standards came out, so we figured they were trying to figure all that out at their little meeting together. So we look at who is involved, who's invested in your local school. So I look at the list to the left. I think about the people that are really involved and invested in local schools, but not any of them were involved in creating Common Core standards. They were consulted, allowed to be part of the process. I didn't get to look at these at the state level and say we like them, we don't. Mendata. Okay, we've all heard of the NSA, right? We've heard of IRS targeting. Well, now the great thing is your school districts at the local level are collecting data on your kids every single day. By law, they're required, thanks to Race to the Top, especially here in North Carolina, because you guys got a bunch of money, to collect data on your kids all the way from kindergarten through post-secondary education and into the workplace. That's a lot to read, so I won't read it to you, but it's called the SLDS grant program. And if you want to just read the bold words again, basically the goal of this database, that will tell you, and a lot of the Common Core proponents will say, Anthony here lived in Vermont, and Anthony moved to Wisconsin. Anthony's file goes with him. So it's great, right? Because the new teacher gets all the information on Anthony from his old school. So they don't have to guess what he knows and what he doesn't know and his personality. They get this great file, and it helps him in the transition.
So the human race is about to enter a totally data-mined existence. And it's going to be really fun to watch. It's going to be one of those things where our grandkids are going to tell our kids, I can't believe you grew up in a world like that, just the way our kids complain that we went to record stores. You know, when Tom Cruise walks through the mall in Minority Report and the ad beams right to his eyes and says, hey, Mr. Cruise, you should go on that Caribbean vacation you've been thinking about. I know some entrepreneurs who are working on that technology right now. The world in 30 years is going to be unrecognizably data mined. So what does that mean for education? Well, education happens to be, today, the world's most data mineable industry by far, and it's not even close, right? So maybe one day healthcare will be up there when they have little nanobots that are in your bloodstream that are doing real-time analysis, but until then, it's not close. Education beats everything else hands down. So let's just compare. Netflix and Amazon get in the ones of data points per user per day. Google and Facebook get in the tens of data points per user per day. So you do 10 minutes of messing around in Google, you produce about a dozen data points for Google. Okay, great. So Newton today gets 5 to 10 million actionable data per student per day. And we do that because we get people, if you can believe it, to tag every single sentence of their content. So publishers, we have a large publishing partnership with Pearson, and they've tagged all of their content. And we're an open standard, so anyone can tag us. If you tag all of your content and you do it down to the atomic concept level, down to the sentence, down to the clause, you unlock an incredible amount of trapped, hidden data.
But what they don't tell you is it's not just Anthony's grades, what classes he took. It's his religion, his family's income, his health screenings, his hobbies, his cultural identity, anything he's ever given a teacher back on a survey, anything he's ever done in the classroom, his homework percentage, all that stuff, it's all in this database.
If somebody tagged every single line, every single sentence of all the world's web pages for Google or every single line of dialogue for Netflix, okay, which no one's done. But even if they had, there are not really a whole lot of interesting correlations there. You do a little bit of work for Newton, and we use just the established science of psychometrics to cascade out hundreds of other data, right? So we can produce incredible quantities of data per user per day. It's really, really hard to get that, okay? But if you can get all that tagging done, and that's what one of our taxonomy, that's a small part of our overall taxonomy. That's just part of one course, right? We have dozens of taxonomies. Then you can do this. What you can do with the data, if you actually do all that work, is you can figure out exactly what students know and how well they know it. You can figure it out down to the percentile versus the rest of the population. So Newton students today, we have about 125,000, 180,000 right now. By December, it'll be 650,000. Early next year, it'll be in the millions. And next year, it'll be close to 10 million. And that's just through our Pearson partnership.
And it doesn't just magically follow a kid one time from one school to the other. Every night, they are required to back this up to a, a hub that collects all of the state databases together and shares that information with one another. And I'll talk to you a little bit about how this now is a partnership with Health and Human Services, and they have access to the data as well.
You learn science best in 42-minute bite sizes. The 44-minute mark, your click rate always begins to decline. You start missing questions you normally get right. You learn social studies best with video clips or 22% video to 78% text or whatever your optimal cocktail of bundle. We can tell when we should return content to you for optimal retention. We literally know everything about what you know and how you learn best. Everything. Because we have five orders of magnitude more data about you than Google has. We literally have more data about our students than any company has about anybody else, about anything, and it's not even close. That's why we can do all that stuff. And we go take the whole combined data power of that network of millions, soon to be tens of millions, eventually to be hundreds of millions of people. And for every single concept that your child learns, 2,000 concepts in a typical semester-long math course, for every single atomic concept, we take the combined data power of that vast network and we use it to find the perfect plan forward for that kid for that concept. So that's what we do right now.
So what can they measure about your kid? All right. So in addition to the traditional stuff you'd see in a report card, your grades, your behavior in the classroom, that kind of thing, there's up to 400 data points that they can track on your child. Last year, I was in Delaware, and I just happened to be speaking to a school board that was passing a resolution to opt out of Common Core at the local level. They were done. They're like, we're going to pass this resolution and send it on to the state. During the open comments, a mom comes up. She's got a survey in her hand. She said, I want you to know this was given to my fifth grader this week in her classroom. And the only reason I saw it, because I'm a copy mom, and I was in the copy room, and I happened to see a copy of it on the copier. Parents would never have known the survey was given to their children. And ask the kids, what is your sexual identity? Have you ever done drugs? Have you ever had sex? Have your parents ever been arrested? Have you ever seen one of your parents do drugs? Do you believe in God? What is your religion? None of that has to do with academic success, but all of it was on her survey. The school board was stunned. At the bottom of the survey, in little print, said developed by Pearson Publishing. Suggested materials for the classroom to help teachers track positive and negative performance of their students. So they could go in and say, kids with low test scores also said that parents do drugs. Or kids with low test scores also said they're having sexual identity problems in the fifth grade.
Right now, we're going to be in K-12 starting next year, and it's an open platform. Anyone can plug in and use it via APIs. And where we think we're going with the data side of it, which is the really fun stuff for today, is we think within a few years we'll be able to start predicting grade performance. So, teacher grades consistently year in and year out. If that teacher grades consistently, we can match up the student profiles, down to the atomic concept level versus grade performance. We can tell you you're on track to get a B- in this course right now. We're really excited to correlate with other people's data sets via our open API, like things like, something we talk about as kind of as a joke, but it really should work, is like a food diary. You tell us what you had for breakfast every morning at the beginning of the semester. By the end of the semester, we should be able to tell you what you had for breakfast, because you always do better on the days you have scrambled eggs or whatever, right? And more importantly, we should be able to tell you what you should have for breakfast.
So these are things that are happening without parental consent. Why is that? The Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals said that once your child enters a public school, you have given up all rights to what they are shared with in the classroom. The Ninth Circuit is not a friendly court to all of us. But they did pass a mandate saying that once your child enters the doors, once you've chosen to send your child to that community school, you have then given the school the right and the ability to give your child any information that they want to and to ask of them any information they are willing to share. because you have entrusted your child to that building and to those teachers.
So the power of data, when you unlock millions of data points per user per day, you can accomplish things that people aren't even conceiving of right now. But that world is coming. We're trying to bring it to you, and we're going to be an open system that will allow anyone to just plug that data, take it out, and then plug it back in. Thanks very much.
Something else to think about with that data, if we go back one more. Looking at dwelling arrangements, career goals, homework completion, behavioral problems. There's also cultural awareness. I was an 8th grade teacher. I tried my best to come in every day and always have an open mind about my students, but they're 8th graders at 14, they're hormonal, and sometimes they drive you crazy. Okay? So if you caught me on a bad day and I had access to a database and I could tell you that Johnny was annoying and he had lacked cultural awareness, I might have done it. So that stays with that kid forever, because teachers are given subjective power to tag kids with labels in this database. So when a kid gets to high school, or when they're going to college for some of these universities that are now accepting this database information, that's there, and it follows them year after year after year. Even the best of teachers get frustrated with kids. How many of your kids, and I don't know, because it's very state to state, when you get a report card in the comments field it says numbers that you kind of have to go look up instead of actual comments that are typed out by the teacher. Do they do that here in some districts? No. It's all comments. So in Texas, they do the codes that are associated with the database already. So I would go in and I would tag Connor with a 41 and an 11 and a 117. The parent would then have to literally go to a website, log in, and see what 41, 11, and 117 means. Some parents will actually go do that. Others aren't going to go and look what those comments mean. Those can mean any of these data points. So you may not know that your child is labeled racist, which is one of the comments of the 400. In their database, that follows your kid. So your second grader repeats a word in the classroom that they might have heard. Teacher's like, oh my gosh, Johnny, you're a horrible kid. I'm going to tag you with this in the database. It stays with them. So that's a really scary thing, a lot of subjectivity in the database. FERPA. So FERPA is supposed to protect your privacy and your kid's privacy, and you're supposed to be able to tell the school what they can and can't share about your kid with other people. 2011, FERPA was changed, so that your local school can decide what information can be shared with viable outside sources that have an interest in public education. So you no longer, even if you opt out, that's an opt out for like newspapers and yearbooks and directories. That's not an opt out to what's shared with the InBloom or the Amplify database. And that's what we're gonna talk about. So, InBloom. They were given $100 million by Bill and Melinda just to build the database to track and analyze all of this information. So how are they going to collect it? What's it going to look like? That's InBloom. I'm always asked why Fox News doesn't talk a lot about Common Core. That's because News Corp is actually part of this data tracking system. They actually own a piece of it. They own one of the analyzation systems that are looking at this data. Now, why would a company like News Corp want access to this information? It's very simple. They get to sell to their advertisers the market, their audience, down the road. They can predict 10 years out now what the fifth graders of today are gonna wanna buy in 10 years, what their technology interests are, what their hobbies are, what their cultural identity is, how they're doing their homework, what subjects they're better in. Okay, they may not get your kid's name, but they're getting all this information. Same with the insurance companies that are part of these programs. Insurance companies, this is invaluable to them, because they can start predicting 10 years out what types of programs they can offer people, what should be included in insurance packages. If they've got access to every kid's vision screening from preschool through the year they graduate high school, they can surely scale their insurance programs to make sure they're going to make the biggest profit off what they're selling. All right, so again, they may not get your kid's name, but they're sure getting a lot of valuable information for their bottom profit line. All right, and again, I mentioned this earlier, but just so you guys know, DC owns the standards, not the government, but two private organizations separate from the government, the NGA and the CCSSO. Meaning, if they don't work for your kids, there's nothing you can do about it. Why? There's an 85-15 rule. North Carolina is really interesting, because you guys have tried this. You will be told, well, it's okay, because we took Common Core, and then we kind of mixed it up a little bit and made it ours. And we added some stuff to it, we took some stuff out, and we own it now. It's ours. We're going to call it something else. We're going to call it North Carolina Core, or whatever we're going to call it. Florida, they're calling it Sunshine Core. So we're going to call it, and then it might could be actually suggested that. He was like, hey, guys, just change the name and nobody will know. Because these people are really dumb, right? No, you guys are smarter than that.
This committee can write legislation, and it's eligible for the short sessions. If this committee were to come up with a new bill, and Common Core, in my neck of the woods, is poison language, it doesn't mean that that's the worst thing in the world, and it certainly doesn't mean it's going to be a panacea for making our kids learn more and no more either. It's not going to be one necessarily. What I want to know is, if we name that thing like North Carolina standards, because I like state pride, I think we ought to brand North Carolina. We've bought into a national movement that's got some good standards, and some standards have rigor. Some are not great and age appropriate. Take the bad ones and throw them out and add our own and have North Carolina standards. What if we were to do something like that? And then control our own curriculum. We get out from that copyright monkey if we call it North Carolina. I can't face voters at home if I call it Common Core anymore. I'm sorry, that's just me. What if something like that were to develop? Could you work with that and with us, or would you stand out there screaming on at the corner?
Senator Chilman, you know I always like to work hand in hand with people to do the right things for our kids in our state. One thing that the state that could be done is to say that the standards for North Carolina shall be officially called the standard course, the North Carolina Standard Course of Study.
The rule states, the Federal Register states that 85% of what is taught in the classroom in a state that is beholden to Common Core has to be the Common Core standards. That means your state only changed them by 15%.
And I know that Representative Hurley was very concerned and wanted to make sure that students are able to memorize the multiplication tables and use those in their work. It was also important, and the General Assembly passed a law that said we shall teach cursive writing, and they were added to the Common Core, and that is an example of how flexible we can be, or we are, because it was without a problem to focus on cursive writing.
But that test is 100% Common Core. So what is your teacher going to be incentivized to teach? The 85 or the 15? The 85. Because their end of the year review depends on how good those kids do on that test that assesses the 85%. So what does this mean? Yes, your local school board can alter the standards. Absolutely, they're not lying to you when they tell you that. But they're not giving you the whole picture. 85% must be what's used in the classroom. Students will only be assessed on the Common Core aligned assessments. The SAT isn't going to reflect the 15% you add to what North Carolina is doing. And if problems arise with the standards, who's responsible? Who is the advocate for the kids in the classroom? Nobody right now, because no one can change them because we don't own them. So how much will it cost? That's really scary, right? How many of you have seen a state budget projection for the implementation of Common Core in North Carolina from state legislators? Is it scary?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty scary. It's about $15.8 billion to the state for the first 2 to 7 years. Washington State alone was $183 million. This is on top of current budgetary requirements. $183 million. California didn't receive any rates of the top money, and they're still beholden to all this stuff. We know how many kids they have in school and in special programs. I can't even imagine how much this is going to cost them. Separate from that, local school districts. So you guys, your local taxes are going to be responsible. And again, these tests aren't required until spring 2015, so you haven't seen this yet. You guys are required for the cost to upgrade your technology and to provide the systems to your kids and to retrain your teachers on how to do this, and to provide those supplemental materials to make sure that you're doing this correctly so you can maintain accountability ratings. All right, even scarier, I'm almost done, I promise. Because I'm probably like, I'm gonna fall asleep. last year, so February of 2013, President Obama in his State of the Union talked about preschool for all. This concept that we need to expand Head Start in these programs so that every kid age 3 in this country is going to a preschool or early childhood program. And he's doing this right now for Race to the Top Round 3. But it focuses on kids 3 to 5 years of age. But it includes expanding that data system to preschool through the workforce, so through 20 years and beyond. That means that your 3-year-old in preschool is now going to be tracked on those same data points that your kindergartner and your 12th grader are tracked on. But the scary thing is, before, it was just a Department of Education database. with race at the top of round three is an equal partnership with the Department of Health and Human Services. So the Obamacare people, now they get this stuff too. Okay? So now when they're offering, when your kid is 18 and they move on, or 26 or 30 at that point, and they get off your insurance, and they go out to apply for their own, all of your information is right there for them to look at and say, oh, but I see in the sixth grade you cut your eye, and I see in the eighth grade you were a little obese, and I see here, they'll have all that information there to look at, your entire health history, because your school wrote it all down and provided it back to the government so they knew it about you. Even scarier is home visits. Built into this program are home visits for people, whether it's the teacher, the administrator, the school nurse, the counselor, whoever's in this program, they tag your child as at risk. You're now part of the home visit program. Your kid brought peanut butter and jelly 4 out of the 5 days this week. We really need to go in your house and examine your ability to provide your child with adequate nutrition. It's really scary. It emphasizes the importance of that. Imagine in the mind of children, when they grow up in a system where the government can come in and tell mom and dad how to feed you, bathe you, dress you, everything about you. Who becomes the parent? It's not the parent, it's the government. Who's taking care of them? That's right. Who's providing for them? Hillary. Oh, my Lord. I don't want to be in her village, okay? I would go back one time. We've seen what that looks like. It's not good. So, again, it provides common standards for preschool, but the greatest part of this is they say, well, listen, this funding is just a one-time deal. You know, you're going to apply for it. We're going to give it to you. After that, you're going to be required to do this, but you've got to fund it. So here's the list of things you could raise sales taxes on to continue to fund this program. And it provides 2 pages of information on items that you can increase your taxes on to help fund early childhood education. They're so nice. See all that work for us. To tell us how we could spend more money to fund a program we don't want. That's so sweet. And then the same system is now being offered to colleges and universities. So public schools that apply for Race to the Top funding are now being incentivized to have a common set of standards for like English 101, History 101, those kind of things at the public university level, and also to back to the database system. And that's all in Race to the Top round three. So who benefits from this program? All these guys. Who loses? Really cool kids that should be taught to dream and to be innovative and to think critically and be creative and become whatever they want to be, not what the government tells them they have to be. I'm afraid we'll end up with a world of Julius, and I don't really want that to happen. So who loses? Us. And that's because of these guys that think they know better than you and me and everyone else what we need to do in our schools. So you guys have been really good listening. Better than 14-year-old students, that's for sure.
Scott Redd, taxpayer and teacher of 15 years. Common Core is no good. People did not ask for it. Once again, it's another thing being jammed down our throats. It violates federal law and invades a family's personal privacy.
Their tears are filling up their glasses. No expression. No expression. Hide my head, I wanna drown my.
Common Core is not about better standards for our children, it's about money.
It promotes educational discrimination among those with special needs, or those who are gifted, or those outside public education.
As a mother of four, I know firsthand that children develop and learn at different rates.
And parents are asking, which hat is Dr. Atkinson wearing in this embattled poll? Is he president-elect of CCSSOs or state superintendent?
Waiting for the day they feel good. Happy birthday, happy birthday.
The education of children in North Carolina has been manipulated by outside trade groups involved by the federal government.
Common Core, No Child Left Behind, Goals 2000, or outcome-based education, it is all the same. It's a federal government's takeover of education. For 30 years or more, we have failed and dumbed down our children. Solution, federal standards? No standards existed until around 1988.
So why are these disturbing to me?
What
They're 7th and 8th grade vocabulary words in the math directions. Persuasive writing is a 4th and 5th grade skill set sometimes introduced in 3rd grade. My son is in 1st grade, and he just turned 7 years old. My daughter, who is required to count to 100 within 60 seconds, as was asked at her 6-year checkup, if she could count to 10, the developmentally appropriate skill for a 6-year-old.
The teach our children to be slaves of corporations, and when the interest of corporations takes precedence, that's fascism.